I'm Michael West, Technical Product Manager at VMware. This is an overview of persistent volume storage in Pivotal Container Service. You're looking at a single worker node from a Kubernetes cluster. Kubernetes clusters deployed with PKS are configured with the vSphere cloud provider so that persistent storage and data services are exposed at the container volume level. The Kubernetes cluster administrator can define a set of storage classes that map to the type of storage required. For example, the disk format might be thin, or it could be thick or eager zeroed thick, or a specific data store might be required. If the vSphere storage policies have been configured, the storage policy name can be referenced here as well. The vSphere cloud provider also surfaces vSAN storage capability parameters like disk stripes, IOPS limits, or cache reservation. Once the storage classes are defined, the Kubernetes cluster administrator can create pools of storage by creating persistent volume claims. The claim defines the actual virtual disk to be created by referencing the storage class and including additional parameters like disk size and access modes. In dynamic volume creation, the VMDK is automatically created and bound to the persistent volume claim as part of the PVC creation. The vSphere cloud provider also supports static volumes. In this case, the vSphere administrator could create pools of virtual disks, and the Kubernetes cluster admin would claim them by creating a persistent volume claim. Application developers define pod specs that create pods and mount the volumes created through the PVC. Should a pod fail, the disk will persist. If a replica set has been defined on the pod, it will be recreated and the disk will be mounted on its file system. Let's jump in and see how this works. We will start by creating a storage class. The only parameter we're going to define here is that we want the disks to be thin provisioned. We've named our class Thin Disk, and we'll use that in the persistent volume claim creation. From our persistent volume claim specification, you can see that we're going to use the thin disk storage class, and we want to create a 2 GB volume. Our persistent volume claim is bound to a vSphere volume, and you can see the 2 GB of capacity and the thin disk storage class. More information can be found using the kubectl describe command, where we can see that the disk was provisioned using the vSphere volume driver. From vCenter, we're going to browse the kubevols data store, and we can see our VMDK has been created and it's been thin provisioned. Now we'll deploy our application. Notice in the deployment spec, we have both the persistent volume claim and the mount point for our persistent disk. We will deploy our application, verify that all the pods are running, and then we'll jump into the web page and see the application itself. Our simple application allows users to vote for their favorite restaurant and includes pods for the database, application server, Redis cache, and the UI. We've added a persistent volume so that our data will be available even after we delete the Redis pod. Let's vote a few times to create some data, and we'll also refresh the page a few times to increase that tally. Now let's delete the Redis server pod where we mounted our persistent volume. We see the existing pod terminating and the new one being recreated. And now the pod's running again. Let's go back to our app and see if the data is still there. We will refresh the page and see if the data resets or if it increments from where we left it. We see that the page views are increasing from 4 and the vote tallies are still in place. Our data survived the recreation of the pod.